it's spreading like a wildfire in my heart. Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Oh, once you choose it, you can lose it. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation, beautiful. I got a heart overflowing in dreams joy. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy.
When the valley that I want,
morning. Welcome to church, everybody. So excited we could come together today. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Mark is handing out candy, so if you want a piece of candy, I'm sure it'll help you out. So excited. It's always good to hear you guys talking. That means you guys are excited. So wonderful, wonderful things. Before we get going, just a couple announcements. Mark, can I get a piece of candy? I think that's what's going. That's what's sending everybody crazy. Right now, Candyman Mark. All right, thank you. I'll take two. All right. Yes, Lyndon Good and Charlene Good is here. So they are awesome, amazing people. So welcome to them. So really, really good. Really, 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 really good. You guys are awesome up there in the balcony. Hi, everybody. I'll just keep talking for a minute as everybody else is talking. So that's good. We are just going for it. Connor, you want this piece of candy? I would throw it, but I don't want to hit that baby right there. So you want to come over here. So you got to jump for it, Connor. Come on. Here you go, Grant. Grant caught it, Connor. So you just got shown up. But anyway, welcome to church. So blessed that you guys could be here. You guys are excited this morning, which is wonderful. We have today in our bulletin, if you're wondering, there is the budget plan for this year. So if you want to see where the breakdown of the funds go, it's in there. If you have any questions, don't ask me, talk to Keith. So it's wonderful. Good. Today, if you are a member, we'll do the congressional vote this morning, and Mark will explain about that. But congregation. Yeah, thanks, Dana. Appreciate you. So we're doing the vote today during both services. So, yeah. Yep. So, all right. I think you guys are amazing this morning. You guys are like full of life. I think it's the music. That's a good job, guys. Good job on the music this morning. So, with that being said, tonight, Bible for Dummies here in the sanctuary at 7 p.m., as well as youth group upstairs, will have food. Time of just fellowship. We've been in the Old Testament on Sunday nights. Wonderful, good times. Other than that, I think I just need to pray. This Wednesday night, costume contest upstairs for the youth. Winner, most creative costume wins $100. So hopefully your students will get creative. Not looking for anything gruesome or nasty, just something funny and awesome and good. It'd be great. Let's pray. God, just thank you so much, Lord. There's an excitement right now in this place, Lord. I appreciate that. I thank you for that, God. I thank you that we could be in this place this morning to worship you, to love you. God, I pray that as we are here, we just give you this offering. We ask that you bless it, that your will be done, Lord. And just, God, in our hearts and our lives as we walk through things, I pray that we position ourselves just to give you those things, to trust you, Lord, in the good and the bad, knowing, God, that you make a way. Knowing, God, that there is no greater answer or thing in this world that will fix us than you. And that will give us exactly what we need it when we need it, Lord, than you. So, Lord, I pray that you bless this time of worship. God, let us just be excited this morning knowing that there is no one else like you. So, Lord, we thank you. We ask that you just come and be in this place. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I'm standing now, I'm not. struck me during that song is the fact that, you know, the big thing now, I guess, is it's just you got to sell out. Sell out on everything you want, you know? It's like if you're interested in this, they expect you to sell out for it. You know, if you're interested in this, they expect you to sell out for that. In other words, they want you to give your whole heart to something that you're really, interested in, desiring or whatever. But I think they're missing the whole point because they're not selling out in the right direction. You know, they're selling out on things that's only going to last temporary. They're selling out on things that are only going to give a small satisfaction time period. They're not selling out for everything. So giving it all just to know him is the best sellout you could ever do. You can't have anything else in life that's going to give as much return as that will. And it goes beyond that into eternity. So you're never going to get anything like that here. Okay? And the more we sell out to him, the more we get to know him. The more we get to know him, the more we learn about him. The more he loves us unconditionally. The fact that he gave his life for us. All of those things, just by getting to know him, we learn so much about everything that he has for us.
Compromise. To know you is to want to tell the world about you.
answers so many questions for us. It really does. A lot of people, you know, what they're really searching for is for love. They're searching for that fulfillment, that satisfaction in their lives. And the only true place they're going to find it is through Christ. You know, and even when you find it, you never know the depth of it, because it is so powerful, so meaningful, and God is so reckless with it. He gives it to any and all. All you have to do is open your arms and accept it. You don't have to do anything other than that, because He loved you just as you are, even before you knew it.
Spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. For I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so good.
Oh,
individuals on Wednesday night when we were singing the song that, you know, I've always focused on the part, the love part in that song and the fact that I don't deserve it. And all of that is true. But I guess I never really caught till Wednesday night how far that love goes. See, because it says there's no shadow he won't light up. There's no darkness in your life. Everything is out in the open with Christ. Christ never holds anything back from you. He's very truthful, very forward, in your face type of thing. If you ask him, he'll show you exactly what you need to see. But it's not even that little bit. It's also the fact that there's no obstacle, there's no wall ever put in front of you that he can't break down. There's a lot of walls we run into, and we'll bang our heads on it forever, 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 until we ask him to break it down. And then he'll break it down. See, God's love is never ending. It's always overcoming. And it's always on our behalf. Because that's the love of our God. That's the power he has to love unconditionally. You know, and that same power that he had all those years ago, from the beginning of time in Genesis until today, 2018, is the same power all the way through. It's not going to change. So we don't have to worry about tomorrow because we know what's going to happen. The same thing happened today, the same thing that happened back then. We don't have to worry about that because he's got it all under control. All we have to do is accept it, rely on it, trust it, ask for it. If we do our part, it's already there. We don't have to worry about anything else.
I can see waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. I can walk down this dark and painful road. I can face every fear of the unknown. Overtaken, we will not be overcome. We'll be right back.
Yes, Lord, we praise you for the power that lives in us, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for it, Lord. Just bless this time and bless this day and all that's going on here, Lord. Bless the word in your mighty and holy name. Amen.
There's a bunch upstairs. Just snag it for people. All right. Good morning. Good to see you. Good to hear you. Glad you're there. Somebody brought me a bag of candy. I gave it all away. It was really hard to give away, I'm telling you. All right. Good morning. Good to see everybody. A little bit different service to start out with this morning. Good drum playing today. Is that your first time? Okay. All right, Dana, you were good as well. You leaving us or are you going to stay here? Right, just stay right here. Hey, once a year, we have to do just a minute of church business, and I'm not going to keep us very long, okay, in this, but once a year, we kind of elect these leaders, okay? So today's a day, if you don't like your pastor, okay, Alandria, all right? By the way, was it last Sunday you were at my house? You're at my house last Sunday, and you hadn't got a ring yet, so I took a piece of aluminum foil and wrapped it around your finger. Today you got a ring, girl, right? Yeah, it's really good. All right, so we're doing our thing, I guess. Hey, so we got to elect these elders and deacons, these. Can't think of any real bad words to say about them. These guys I really like. So we got to have deacons up here first, okay? Deacons up here, I'm going to introduce you to the deacons of the church real fast, because we're going to give you a little paper ballot in a second to say yes or no on them. If you're a deacon, come. If you're not a deacon, stay. Same old guys come every time. Can you believe it? Got that microphone right there. You know how to turn it on? Here they come. In our church, we told the state of Ohio we would elect our leaders through a congregational vote once a year, okay? So that's what today is for just a minute. We're going to do a little bit of church business. We believe in elders and deacons. Elders doing the ministry in the church. Deacons do the business of the church. These are the businessmen of our church, okay? What's great is I don't have to do anything related to the business. You guys know this already. I don't know what you give. I don't know what the electric bill is. I don't care. I do, but not like that. So, it's good to see you all here today. Here's the deacons of your church. I'm going to let you kind of know them already, so let them introduce themselves. Start with Keith right there.
Hi, I'm Keith Rooney. I'm the treasurer. I got a heckler down here.
She's there all the time.
I know.
She's there all
she's
the
giving
time.
Me trouble. Hi, Bev. There you go.
Thank you.
I got one. I've been the treasurer now for 4 or 5 years, and anyhow, I'll just put a plug in for the budget, what we're trying to do here this year. We've been really blessed. Over the last 2 years in a row, we've had record-level giving for this church coming in, and so we've tried to reflect that in our budget going forward and kind of increase some amounts to things, and what we're really pushing towards this time is more in children's ministry and more in missions. So if you will allow us to do that and just give faithfully as you have been and whatever God lays on your heart, we appreciate that. And that's the budget item there, and you'll see the chart in your bulletin and all that. So we just thank you for trusting in us to do what we do, and come talk to us anytime if you have any questions or suggestions or any of that. Thanks.
Wonderful.
Hi, good morning. I'm Jim Lee. Been on the deacon board for about 3 years, something like that now. Been going to church here for a little over 20 years. Just got done playing music, trying to, and just happy to be serving you guys. So.
Hi, I'm Dana Horsley. I've also been coming about 20 years and served in all kind of capacities, doing all kind of stuff. Anyways,
I like to tell the story, and I like to pick on you.
Okay.
Yeah, you're waiting on me to pick on you.
No, you don't.
Like
you always pick up
a spot there where it's kind of, you know, you're waiting on me to jump in. You started coming to church here because your brother was the plumber that was plumbing here, and he told you about us.
Yes.
Right.
Then I had to fix the urinal.
And then the only urinal we had broke, right? And you came and fixed it.
And then I looked around, and I was looking for a church.
You were looking for a church, and you played music, and we needed that.
Yeah. I saw drums, and they were sitting on a shelf. They wasn't up. They was on a shelf back there.
And that was a sign that you need help, right?
Yeah.
And we did, and you did.
Yeah.
And we're very grateful.
Okay.
Very grateful. All right. That's short and sweet. That was short and sweet, wasn't it? In the first service, it was long and argumentative. This service, it was short and sweet. Okay. Don?
Hello. I'm Don Smith. And I've been a deacon for about 3 years, and I thank you all for your generosity.
Yeah, wonderful.
Hi, I'm Tony James. We've been coming here about 10 years. Been on the deacon board for 3 or 4 years now, so very glad to serve you.
Thank you very much, fellas, and for the work they do. There's your business folks in the church, okay? They run the business of the church. If you have any trouble with anything in the church, see them, okay? If it's too hot, if it's too cold. Yeah, it's cold right now. It's burning up. It's burning up. You ought to stand here. It's burning up here. I'm just telling you right now. Hey, what they'd like to do, because they're trying to serve you right now, they're going to pass out these ballots. If you're a member in the church, kind of grab them here, and they'll give you a ballot to fill out. And the basket will be over by these doors to put your ballots in when you go out today, okay? All right. Now the elders in the church. You got elders in the church here? I think we got a few of them, the ministry people in the church, people actively doing ministry in our church, right here with us right now. These are supposed to be the geniuses of the church right here. The geniuses are on their way. I saw Keith roll his eyes there as he passed by. Oh, boy. Okay, here's the elders in your church. They do ministry in your church.
My name is Justin Raines. A lot of you guys know me. I am the youth pastor here. I started coming to church here in 2006, so that is 12 years, I think, if I do the math right.
Yeah,
it's crazy, 12 years, blink of an eye. But me and my wife, we are blessed to be able to do youth ministry here. We love your youth. We have a desire to see them. To just have an encounter with Jesus that will not just be a moment, but will make an everlasting change in their eternity. And to get to see God move and grow in their life is a beautiful, amazing thing. You guys have wonderful, amazing kids, and we're blessed to be part of their lives. So,
I'm sorry, but you grew up here in the youth ministry here.
Yes.
And Lachelle, your wife, grew up in the youth ministry here. You met and married your wife out of the youth ministry here.
Yep. It's crazy. I mean, I look up where all the youth are sitting up there, and, like, I remember I prayed about who to take to prom, and that's God showed me her, and I'm like, oh. But I could just think about just the memories. You know, the church is an amazing, wonderful place to be and to have your youth and just family. Just crazy. Now I'm raising kids in the church and just wild, amazing, wonderful, beautiful. Also, I make you guys coffee out there, so vote for me.
He makes the coffee, so there you go.
We love you.
Yeah. Woohoo!
I'm Dave Hamilton. Been going here a little over 20 years. I look around and I see a lot of old familiar faces, and I see a lot of new ones. And I'm just thankful to be a part of this church where we have a pastor like Mark, which I'll have to say I've gone to church practically my whole life. I've never met a guy like Pastor Martin.
Yeah, that's true.
And I wish there were more of them, I'll tell you. I love it here. They put me in as an elder for whatever it is. I teach Sunday school and do what I can, but I don't, you know, the position doesn't matter to me. I'm going to keep on doing what I do for the Lord, regardless of whatever it is. And I'm just thankful for you guys, because we go through some tough spots in life, you know, and we're here to help each other out. And so anything we can do to help you guys, give us a holler.
Right. Wonderful. Thanks.
Good morning. My name's Clay Miller. I've been an elder for a year now. I lead a young adult Bible study on Thursday nights out of our home. So if anybody's interested, my contact information is in the bulletin, or you can just come and stop me. I've been coming to Renewed Strength since about 2003, back when I was skinny and didn't get winded walking up those three stairs. times have changed, but
yeah.
I love the church and love everybody in here. And often when I do get the chance to speak, I love to see everybody get up and mingle, because, like I said, there's people upstairs that I see new faces every day. So it's just a great church, and there are a lot of caring hearts here. So just make it a place where I always say, don't just come to church and head out the door, head to the Frisch's, you know, mingle afterwards and get to know one another. It's a great place to be.
Yeah. Thanks, Clay.
I'm Brian Ward. My wife and I, we've been here 15 years, I think, give or take a little bit. We've raised our children here. They're grown now. And I just consider it a privilege to be able to do this. And if any of you have any needs, you guys, we're like family. I hope we are to each other. And it's like Clay said, I hope you don't just come and go on a Sunday, but you start to get to know people and get involved. And if any of you have needs that maybe you can't talk to the pastor about, or you need another set of ears or another somebody to pray for you,
right,
our phones are available. We want you to realize that, not be afraid to call us. We'll stop and we'll come and we'll pray and we'll try to help you through something. We don't have all the answers, but we know where to go to get them. So thank you.
Right. And then Joe Ford. You all know Joe Ford. Joe Ford has just been here a long time, getting older. And he's been here for both services for years and years and years and years and years and years. Today I saw him go out the door, and that just means to me that he's struggling with his legs. He's just older. But Joe loves you, would love to pray for you. He said in the first service, just email him. He'll pray for you. I'm thinking the oldest guy in the church is getting email, man. So anyhow, these fellas love you, want to pray for you, want to be part of your life, want to be able to minister to you, encourage you in the Lord. So if you ever need us, call us, okay? If you can't get me, there they are, okay? And they're a lovely backup set right there. So also, if you need prayer after church anytime, if you need to talk to somebody during church anytime, these fellows will be glad to do that, okay? They'll even grab their wives and talk, okay? So we'd like to help you anytime we can. I know sometimes people come to church and are in the middle of trouble. So if we can be part of helping you, bringing God into your decision-making or your direction forward, we'd love to help in doing that, okay? Very good. There's your elders, okay? Thanks. All right, one last piece of business we still need to do this morning is, Leslie, you're still here. Come on, Leslie, real quick. I turn this microphone off and just got to turn it right back on. Leslie right here is going to Vietnam this week. You know, we have an older couple. We have a couple in our church that aren't young, but they're not old. Ministering in Vietnam, Thomas Anthony Lewis, after a bunch of years in Africa, they came back, decided they were going to make this their home church. Came here for probably 10 years, and then felt a call to go off to Vietnam, okay? So, what happens here at our church is often we're trying to get people involved in trying to bless them. There's some cards here in the front. If you want to send a message to Tom and Cynthia Lewis in Vietnam, Leslie's going to take them tomorrow. She's leaving tomorrow to take those cards and your message to them. So if you want to fill out these cards with any kind of greeting you'd like, Leslie will take that. But she's going to Vietnam. Now here's what we do with Leslie, just so you know, okay? Leslie's kind of been the fill-in person. A year ago, Trent, my son-in-law, you know, my daughter's in Peru. They're doing ministry in Peru. They had to come back here for like 8 weeks while he had open-heart surgery. We sent Leslie. Leslie did ministry. You know, if you leave the mission field, that ministry usually just kind of goes barren. It just kind of goes dry, and you have to go back and kind of restart, and it's really wonderful to plug a substitute in. So We're sending Leslie to Vietnam now to kind of learn Tom and Cynthia's ministry. They do a college-age ministry. Teaching English. It's just conversational English. And they teach people about the Lord through conversational English. Leslie's going to kind of learn the ropes in case they have to come back for some reason, or Leslie can run back over there and fill in their ministry while they're gone. So we not only have people out on the mission field, but we have a substitute. So we're sending her to Vietnam for the very first time to kind of hook up there, be there a while, learn their system, and be able to go back if they need help, okay? So there's cards. Here's Leslie. All right.
Yes. Leaving tomorrow, if you feel a need to send anything, send a message. If there's not enough room in these cards, you just write it on a piece of paper, give it to me, I'll give it to them.
Right.
I've been doing mission work since I was 12 years old. Took my first trip to Peru, South America, and it's my call. That's my hashtag, Heart for Missions. And so it's just, I go where I'm needed. And if God calls me to go, then that's where I'm going to go.
Simple as that, okay? Hey, right here, give me your hand. Father, bless Leslie. She goes out of here. A substitute teacher, Lord. We send her in, Lord, to learn the system. Lord, bless her as she goes and as she comes and everything in between. Lord, I know her. I've traveled with her many times. You can use her. Lord, use her. If you can use anything, Lord, lose Leslie in the next few weeks. God, just bless her with words to speak. Lord, just with a smile on her face, Lord, just plow her into the lives of people and let them see Jesus in her and let them want to know Jesus because of her. Use her, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, thank you all. Wonderful. Isn't that all exciting and wonderful? All right. Plus, on the day I get voted on, somebody gives me candy to give away. Isn't that great? It couldn't be any better timing than that. Oh, God, let me give them another reason to love me. And somebody bring me a bag of candy to give away. They said, just throw it. They're like me. I just love to throw candy around, but I'm worried about hitting Bev Vargo. She sits right under that glass. So when I throw it and everything hits the glass, hits her in the head. Dana said a minute ago, well, we didn't hurt nothing. So I also want to welcome Lyndon Good and his wife today. Lyndon's been a seasoned pastor across the county, very respected man in our county. And for him to be here today, it's just a privilege to have him here. If I can be anything like that guy in his reputation, I'd be blessed. So love on him a little bit, okay? He served the community as a pastor for a lot of years, and he's a really, really good dude, okay? Good brother in the Lord, and we're excited he's here with us. Today, we're in this series, the third class of our series, where we want to make you a member of the church. So we ask you to kind of sit through 6 weeks of a series. Normally we do this one-on-one, but in the fall like this, sometimes because busy people are so busy, we just teach our basic discipleship series to you about this time of the year, last few years, okay? So we're in the third lesson of that, and it's about the Bible. The third lesson in our discipleship series is about the Bible. The Bible's the coolest book ever. The Bible's amazing and lovely and wonderful, right? Now, I teach a class on Sunday night in the fall called Bible for Dummies. The reason why I do that is I want people in our church to be smart about the Bible. Here I am, grew up in church, a lot of years in church, grew up in church, got to Bible college and realized I don't know the whole storyline of the Bible. I didn't know that. I said to myself, hey, you know what, it's kind of not right for people to be in church for lots of years and not know how the Bible, how the storyline Bible goes from Genesis to Revelation and not really understand that. I knew all the Bible stories, but I didn't know how it all fit together. So Bible college was a hard lesson for me because I had to do a lot of catching up. What was great was all the other incoming freshmen at Bible college didn't know it either. And I realized, you know, even though we hear preaching, which is wonderful, and that's what God really wants us to hear, the Word of God preached to us, because it's powerful in our lives, the Lord wants us to have understanding of the Scripture itself. This book is amazing. You know, people say often this is God's love letter written to us. This is how God, one of the ways God wants to communicate to us what His heart and will is for our life. And as Christians, it ought to be important that you have a discipline in your life to be in the Word of God. We have something here called a daily bread. It's just a little one-page little storybook where you can read some verses and hear and read a little story that goes, listen, at least commit yourself to 5-10 minutes of a daily bread. Put it in the bathroom. Right? Commit yourself to some type of Bible study. Now hear me for a minute. It'll change your life. I started to learn as a young Christian, I started to learn the greatest thing I can do as a Christian, the thing that was most powerful in my life, when I got up in the morning, pray. And when I started getting up in the morning, praying in the morning was so powerful. I get up and I pray, and I started realizing my life was changing and circumstances were changing because I get up in the morning and pray. Then I began to realize that this thing's really amazing. And then when I have trouble in my life and things I didn't understand, sure enough, if I just asked the Lord for some guidance and I'd go kind of searching around a little bit, I'd find right here in the Word of God guidance for me. I can't tell you how many times this thing has just lit my life, lit my path up, man. Just told me what to do. Told me where to go. Told me how to live. I try to tell people all the time about the Word of God. Just the best thing I can tell you is this was written for you. Read it, believe it, receive it. You know what I mean? I think it's Joel Osteen that says, this is my Bible. He makes you say, this is my Bible. And he makes you say, believe everything in it, receive everything in it. It's good, it's powerful, it's the Word of God for you. Hey, read it, believe it. If the Lord says he's your healer, he's your healer. Right? If the Lord says he's your helper, he's your helper. If he says he's your strength, he's your strength. Right? If he gives you direction, I'll just tell you this crazy story. My wife's here and I like to talk about her. My wife was reading one place in Daniel a bunch of years ago. And she was reading and one passage said, go and work for the Persian king. It will be well with you. She's reading a Daniel story. Go with the Persian king, it will be well with you. And she said when she read that, the Lord spoke to her and said, that's for you. And she's like, go work for the Persian king, it will be well for you. She came to me. I'm still sleeping in bed because she gets up and studies the Bible early. I'm in deep meditation. She comes in and says, Mark, Pastor Mark. She doesn't say Pastor Mark. She says, dummy. Hey, I just read this Bible verse, and it said, go work for the Persian king, it'll be well with you. And I know the Lord said that was for me. I don't understand. What is it? I'm like, huh? I said, honey, I don't know. Do we even know a Persian king? Maybe you're going to sell rugs or something. I have no idea. I got no idea what at times. And then she leaves the room, and I go, cuckoo, cuckoo. About 2 weeks later, a man approaches her and says, come to work for me. His name was Fry Shakuri. I can't say his name right. He was a Persian man who was the county engineer. Walked up and said, come to work for me. I want you to come to work for me. The Persian elected official, the Persian king, said, come to work for me. And my wife said, you're the Persian king, man. I'm going to come work for you and it'll be well. And she went to work with him and it was lovely and amazing. He just passed away not long ago. But she worked for him for a number of years. He was amazing and lovely to her. She adored him and he adored her and it was beautiful. Just when you think in the most obscure places in the scripture, there's no guidance there. Sure enough. My wife, listen to me, at our house we take guys in out of jail and prison. We live in an old school building. We still have the chalkboards on the wall. My wife will write scripture verses on the wall. Oh my gosh. She'll put it in their bathroom. She'll put it in our bathroom. She'll put verses for me in our bathroom. We got a verse right across from the toilet. I hate to make so many toilet references, but right across from the toilet, we got chalkboards in our bathrooms. We got verses written on our bathroom walls. If you don't think the pastor and his wife realizes how powerful the Word of God is in our life, it's our life, it's our light, it's our connection with God. You know, it's kind of like praying. God invites us into the holy place. God invites us into his very throne room. You know, we'd love to have an invitation to the White House or to the Oval Office, you know, and we'd see that as some great honor. But God lets us come right in and talk. What's he say? Boldly approach the throne of grace. Come boldly to me. Come ask me. Come petition me for what you need. God gives us this great invitation. And you know what? The invitation is so great. The opportunity is so great that often what we do is just neglect it. We just kind of ignore it. We just don't see it as that important. We see God as busy, or our word spoken to him is not that important. And we do the same thing sometimes with the Bible. We just don't value it for the great value in which it has for our lives. Next slide for me. This is some of the Bible for Dummy stuff, okay? History of the Bible. This, I'm trying to put some English stuff here. The Bible was canonized. You know, canonized means grouped together. Constantine became the emperor. In the day, he was a Christian man. All these individual books were scattered throughout. He made a kind of declaration that I want all these Christian books put together, these Jewish and Christian books put together. And the greatest scholars of the day had certain criteria, and they canonized the Bible. They grouped the Bible. That grouping in 400 AD remains today as what we know as our Bible. It wasn't, you know, in Jesus' time there wasn't a Bible. You know that, don't you? There was the books of Moses and other writings, and but it wasn't until Constantine came that our Bible formed in 400 AD. The New Testament got translated by William Tyndale from Greek in 1562. In English for the first time. And then old King James, what I understand is that his servants, to give it, he wanted to know about God. He wanted to know this Bible. It was hard for him to read. So his servants got together and came together with the greatest translation in the day of the original text, or I shouldn't say the original text, but of the oldest manuscripts we had. They studied and studied and studied, and that's how we got the King James Bible in 1611. When you read the King James Bible, you're reading what English sounded like in 1611. You get that? Now, for most of us, next slide, for most of us, we have two different types of Bibles. There are two different types of Bibles out there. There's a Bible that was literally translated, meaning it was translated like a word-for-word translation. Or we have this type of Bible out there that's paraphrased, meaning it was a thought-for-thought type of translation. Everybody get that? These are the versions of Bible that are literal. Of course, the King James, the New King James, the NIV, the New Revised Standard, American Standard, paraphrased Bible, or these living Bibles, these New Living Bibles, the way, the easy-to-read versions of things. Say, Pastor, how do you feel about that? I feel it's all for good. And any way you read the Bible is good. Are there bad translations of the Bible out there? Yeah, but these aren't those. If you have a paraphrase version, you can look in front of your Bible how it was translated. God, let me just tell you a translation story. There's still over 200 languages the Bible hasn't been translated into. I'll just tell you how one really close to us. You know Jamie Ketchell? Jamie, we're hoping someday, that's my little push, we're hoping he works with these kids and learns the language, and we're pushing him to pastor a church called in DeMonte Azul. The man that's there right now in a very remote part of northern Peru, the man that is there right now pastoring, his name is Nixon. It's easy to remember because you know why. Anyhow, that Nixon man is traveling even farther north in the most remote parts of the jungle, up there even where the Elliots were, in that region, on that Curry River and in that whole region up there. Hey, and they speak a language called Quechua. There's no translation for the Bible in Quechua. Nixon is trying to translate the Bible into Quechua. We're trying to get Jamie Ketchell up there to pastor at a church so that Nixon can go into the Quechua language, translate the Bible, and minister to the Quechua people. You'll understand that? You don't realize you're that close on the edge of trying to help get this new translation of the Bible out there, and the man doing it, we're one person removed from the man that's trying to help do that. You get that? And the Bible over the years has been translated into many different languages. Hey, people have lost their life of great personal cost. Years and years ago, when we had a youth pastor here named Scott Mendenhall, the Dead Sea Scrolls came through the area, and they were over in Columbus, and Scott and I went over to look at these Dead Sea Scrolls over in Columbus, that these ancient manuscripts were found in the mid-40s, late early 50s, mid-40s, along the Dead Sea. They've been preserved very well in clay pitchers. We don't have the original text, but we have very, very old manuscripts of the Bible. And what we found in that whole study all those years ago when I went over there, with those Dead Sea Scrolls, ancient manuscripts of different books of the Bible, lined up exactly with the modern day translation of the Scripture. God has preserved His Word incredibly accurately. Incredible. You hear me? Now, usually, let me say this to you, if you find a mistake in the Scripture, usually it's in how modern day people numbered it. because the writer of the Bible didn't put numbers in there. He didn't put chapters and verses. So lots of times, where they put a verse or something, they may have cut a thought in half. But the original text is so accurately translated in our modern-day Bibles, it's incredible. You're reading, you have in your hand a book that God has preserved incredibly accurately. His heart preserved for your understanding. Does that make sense? It's amazing and wonderful. Okay? So those are just some thoughts about the Bible. I will tell you, in the United States of America, the Bible's the number one seller. Worldwide, the Bible's the number one seller. New York Times has a list of number one. They ignore the Bible because every year the Bible will be on top. There's an incredible interest in the Scripture. You go places in the world, when you come as a Christian, they're saying, did you bring Bibles? We know a man in Tyler, Texas, a YWAMer in Tyler, Texas. I think he's still involved with this. They were involved in a YWAM base in China that was baking bread. And North Korea is so poor, that they would receive bread shipped in out of China into North Korea. But a YWAM base was actually taking pages of the Scripture and hiding it in the baked loaves of bread. They were sending in a page a day as they sent bread in, and they were trying to get the whole Bible sent in loaves of bread rolled up, and they'd mark it some way so that the underground church in North Korea would realize this one has a page of the Bible in it, and they'd grab it with joy, and they'd read it, and they were hungry for it, and they knew that it was God's Word for them. And we throw it up on the shelf and let it get dusty. You know what I mean? 2 Timothy says, all Scripture was given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, instruction in righteousness. The Scripture was given, inspired by God to help us, to correct us, to give us instruction, to be what we need, to give us what we need. Next verse. That the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. What's the heart of God? That you're equipped for His work. Right? And He'll write in there things that'll correct you and instruct you and help you. But He's trying to equip you. We should say we are pistol-packing Pentecostals. Say that 10 times fast. Pistol-packing Pentecostals. Hey. That you would be fully equipped to do the work that God has required you to do. I will tell you, as the Lord has put more responsibility on Jamie and I in ministry, we've needed to be more and more and more equipped with His Word. I don't know if you understand that, but we can't go farther unless we get deeper in the Word of God. We can't do more for the Lord unless we understand His Word more. We're not studying the Word less, we're studying the Word more. I went to a conference, an audio conference, Bruce and I did. Bruce, remember we went? They gave us a free meal at Golden Corral. Remember that? And a guy was selling sound equipment, but he was a pastor. And he would say, and he was pushing this series of Bible on CD or Bible in some way, because he would say to us pastors, pastors, people can listen to Christian music in the car, they can listen to country music, they can listen to whatever, but you're missing this golden opportunity. You ought to be pushing the Word of God on people to have it where they can hear it in their car, where they can hear it every place they go. People ought to be listening to the Word, because there's nothing more powerful in your life than the Word of God. I know there's worship songs that really feed you and help you and are good for you, but there's nothing more powerful for you than the Word of God. Every Sunday morning, you don't know this, but every Sunday morning, I start over here towards church. And I'll just pick up my phone and say, read to me whatever chapter we're in that morning. Read to me that chapter, and I'll listen to that chapter three or four times just on my drive to work out my fancy phone. You know what I mean? That makes sense? You hear me? I will listen to the Word of God. I will listen to the Word of God. I'll listen to the Word of God. Before I ever preach it, I'll read it, but I'll listen to it. Because, you know how important hearing the Word of God is? I've told you this before. God used a preacher or preaching the Word of God as this powerful instrument to get to your heart. Because your ear is more connected to your heart than any other thing. You know, when I speak something in your ear, hey, it's like an IV, man. It goes straight to your heart. Right? Let me give you an example. Because if you speak something positive to people, you know what I mean? It builds them right away. Does that make sense? Cindy, you're lovely. You're lovely. You're amazing. Jenny, we're so glad you play the piano here for us. We love you. We couldn't live without you. I know you don't feel like people notice. I notice you're wonderful. Cheryl, of course you're wonderful. You're so wonderful. You guys, right there, you four right there, something good, man. I don't know what it is. Something good. There's something happening in your life, and you're never going to be the same. That Douthwaite boy, man, hey, you showed back up at the game Friday. That dude's a tackler. I've been telling you about him, man. Douthwaite on the tackle. That dude, man, I'm telling you, we need to just let him tackle people in the foyer out here. That might be his only talent, the tackling people, you know what I mean? And we want people to do their talent in church, right? So, listen, we went to a football game to watch our boy play. He caught a couple touchdown passes. It was pretty exciting for us to think our boy we never thought would amount to nothing. That's a joke. Caught a couple touchdown passes. We couldn't believe anybody even throw it to him. It's a joke. But watch Mr. Douthwaite right there tackle and him be in our church. Now, I did all that because you know how powerful those words spoken? They go right in your ear, right to your heart. And they do something real. Just think about a negative word spoken to you, how it cuts right to your heart. That's why God uses preaching. That's why it's important you hear the Word of God, because that's one direct way it goes like an eye straight to your heart, that you might be thoroughly equipped for every good work. God doesn't want you halfway equipped. You ever went camping and not have what you need? You ever been camping, didn't bring any rain gear, and it rained the whole weekend? Anybody ever done that? There's nothing more miserable than trying to do something and not being equipped, right? You ever been with an Eagle Scout going camping? They got everything, man. That dude's equipped, you know what I mean? He even knows how to tie knots. My point is, you want to be equipped. Things are coming, not just for your life, but for your children. Hey, and for your children's friends and for your neighbors and for your friends. Listen, wouldn't it be awesome that you read something this morning? Before the day was over, the Lord used you. Has that ever happened to you? It happened to me all the time. The very thing. We live in a crazy world, right? I'll just tell you. We live in this crazy, crazy world right now. God is not the author of confusion. I've been kind of studying this whole thought of confusion. Because what I sense is there's more confusion than there's ever been. And this whole thing, I've been with the Lord just kind of going over, Lord, why do I talk to Christian people and they say they're confused? The word as a pastor I hear a lot is I'm so confused. Listen, God isn't the author of confusion. What? Everybody, listen to me. Everybody ought to know who you are in Christ. You ought to know who you are. You ought to know what God has gifted you to do. You ought to be trying to serve in some kingdom capacity in doing what God has called you to do. And there ought to be a peace in that. Every relationship you're in, listen, you need to work. Hey, for God to be in it, for there to be a peace in it, you want peace. When God's there, there's a peace. It might be challenging. It might not be easy, but you know you're doing what. Leslie, just a minute ago, said, I know this one. Hashtag something. Heart for mission. So she knows exactly what. I wish we all had this. I know what I know. Now listen to me. And pray you have that. But you say, man, everything's so confusing. What I've been trying to tell people lately is God's not the author of confusion. But if you hang around people that are confusing, they'll bring confusion right in on you. And you got to be careful that you don't get caught in their confusion and you keep doing what you know God has called you to do. Hey, because the enemy is so able to distract, so trying to get you caught up in confusion, getting you so worried about all this stuff, trying to steal your peace. If you got confusion in your life, pray that it isn't confusion because you don't know what God's heart is for you. It's usually because there's people around you that sow confusion. And it's pretty hard to live with somebody or be with somebody or work with somebody that's got all this confusion and not have confusion want to be on you. Does that make sense? And it's this idea that what we pick up out of the Word of God begins to give us, I don't know, when a preacher is doing a good job, you kind of come and you hear something and it's just like, oh, man, I needed that. That deposited something in me that, oh, wow, that was a truth I didn't fully understand. So the Bible wants to, every issue in life, everything you're going to, there's instruction for your marriage. There's instruction for your children. There's instruction for the next problem you have. And if you don't know how to search that out, nowadays with the modern day internet, because you can believe everything on the internet, but you can pretty quickly find those things. Or you can come talk to these pastors and elders that are in your church that would love to help you. My problem, I'm getting off the subject here a little bit about the Word of God. My problem is God will often use us to speak to people, but their heart, we'll get to that in a minute. Next verse here, Cullen, you still with me? This is the verse you learn at Bible college. We used to learn in the King James Version, study to show yourself approved. A worker who need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. We learned that a long time ago in Bible college, that you should be a studier in this particular version. Be diligent. Be diligent. You got to be diligent. You know, God's stuff, you have to be diligent to go get. Right? The Lord did his work. God came after you, didn't he? The Lord gave his life for you and he chased you down. He came to try to reveal himself to you. I would believe, you know, God's obligation is that he saved you. He made a way for you to be saved. But beyond that, he reveals himself to you in some capacity. And at that point, it's about you being diligent in the pursuit of him if you're ever going to walk in the things of God. Right? The Lord has paid for our sin through his work. Hey, and he's revealed to all of us that he is God. From that point, you got to be diligent to go after him. Does that make sense? I'm going to get from the Lord what I'm in pursuit of from the Lord. You all get that? The Lord wants to be very near. You understand? The Lord wants to be very near. If you resist the devil, he'll flee. But the Lord wants to draw very near to you. The Lord wants to be near. The Lord wants to be closer than a brother. The Lord wants to be very close. We keep the Lord sometimes at a distance that he doesn't. He loves a relationship with you. I don't know why I'm telling you this story, but I was raised in a home where my parents said, hey, unless an adult talks to you, don't talk. Our parents were pretty strict. You know, when adults were around, quiet. So I grew up with this understanding of don't talk unless you're talked to. Be very respectful. My parents taught me, don't talk, they'll figure out how dumb you are. You know what I mean? So only answer the question. So I grew up, now get this, my parents put in me, don't talk. My dad, it's probably the wrong, my dad put in me, don't show your emotion. So I grew up with all this stuff, you know what I mean? And even in talking to God, because my parents put in me, don't talk, until somebody, some preacher someday talked to me about, just spoke to me about how much God loves to hear me talk to him. He loves me. I love my wife. I love her. I love her. Last night she rode with the highway patrol. This morning at 5:30 when I got up getting ready for church, she was ready to tell me what happened on highway patrol last night. Last night, by the way, just so you're as wise and informed as I am, last night at all the bars in Springfield was their Halloween dress-up night, and there were more zombies in Springfield drunk last night than you could ever believe. Highway Patrol was staying close to these bars last night because they were trying to catch zombies, drunk driving. Hey, let me tell you something. When my wife loves me, she's talking to me. When she doesn't like me, she doesn't talk. You all get that? Okay, men, did you hear that? When your wife isn't talking, trouble. And I wouldn't say, what's wrong with you? Let me just give you a couple things. The best way to kind of break the ice is say, how'd your day go? Oh, really? Then what happened? Then what did you say? No way. What happened next? Hey, and all of a sudden she stops being mad and just starts talking to you. Because in the heart of a lady, they want to love their husband. They want to. And they want their husbands to care. I don't know how I got on that, but hey, be diligent. Hey, study your Bible. Rightly know what it says. You got me? Next one, I got to hurry. I'm running out of time. I don't know why that says none. This ain't Catholic. Psalms 119. Your word is the lamp unto my feet and the light unto my path. I've talked about that. The Lord will light up your path if you're in his word. Now hear me. Hear me real quick. I'm going to try to help you. From the foundation of the world, God knew you. You all understand this? And God puts you here now because there's something he wants you to do. You are a covert agent. You are, maybe I shouldn't say covert, maybe you ought to be the light of the world, not covert. You are an agent for God, and he has a path for your life. There is one path for your life. You understand this? There's one. Everything you need is on the path for your life. You don't, hey, if you need a spouse, you don't go to Bracken's. Okay? You stay on God's path for your life. Everything you need is on the path for your life. If you need help, if you need this, if you need, stay on God's path for your life. I can't tell you how many times I've been troubled by something. I went to church in that very moment, or I opened my Bible in that very moment. God spoke exactly what I needed to me. Stay on God's path for your life, and God will light it up for you if you stay in his word. Y'all, everybody hear me? Want your path to be lit? Your word is the lamp to my feet and the light to my... You want to know what the path... I don't know where I'm going. Get in his word. He'll light the path. People, there's some things that are just simple. Where do I go in life? What am I supposed to do? Get in his word. He'll light your path. Simple. It's almost like a promise God makes for you. When you don't know what to do, if you'll get in his word... He'll light the path. It's just like the light, the landing lights come on, you know what I mean? Where's the runway? I don't know. Well, getting his word, the landing lights will come on. It'll make sense. It'll all, in fact, God is, I got to go. Next one. Therefore, hear the parable of the sower. This is about God's word being sown. Hey, and God's word is good and powerful and amazing and can do great things in your life. It'll return 100 or 60 or 30 fold. We're going to see God, the greatest investment you could ever do is make an investment in God and in his word, because the return from that is greater than any return you'll ever get in any other investment. You'll see that at the end. But as a pastor, I know as I speak, there's four different types of soil. The issue isn't that the word is bad. The word of God is good, right? The word of God is good. This is what I know. If I could preach the word of good God to you, it is alive. I preach it alive. It gets in you. I can walk away. And you know what? A living word inside you is just going to bounce around, hey, and change you. Right? Only thing I can do is preach God's word. It gets in you. I can't tell you how many times people have said, have I said this already? Sometimes I get confused. People come and say, years ago, you said this. You remember when you said that? No. Oh, you don't? Because I've never forgot it. It bounced around inside of me. It really changed. I've been changed by that thing you said to me. I'm like, I don't even remember. Because the living word of God getting inside of you will overhaul you for good, right? Hear the parable of soil, four different types of soil. You're a type of soil. Your heart's a type of soil. The first type of soil is right there, next one. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, and the wicked one comes and snatches it away, what was sown in the heart? This is he who receives seed by the wayside. The first type of heart condition, the word of God wants to come, penetrate that, be fruitful, do great work in your life. But if your heart is hard, a seed laying on a path, it's easy for a bird to come and eat it. A seed hitting a hard surface will not penetrate it. And what comes from it? Nothing. I'm so surprised. You can't believe, as a pastor, what I pick up on. I've done this for a while. I pick up on every single yawn. You can't yawn here without me catching it. I'm just telling you. You might say in the back, I got it. I got you every time. I got you every time, man. Don't worry, I got you. Sometimes I'll even look the other way like I didn't see that, but I got it. In jail, in a jail service, I do a lot of jail services. There'll be guys in the back saying, hey, I want to go. Can I get out of here? At the very same moment, tears will be running down the face of guys in the front row. And you start realizing, is the word I'm preaching bad? No, it's the type of heart that's receiving it. There are moments I get up here. I've done this long enough. There's moments I get up here, hey, and I'm telling a story or something. Listen, when I'm not very excited, people are coughing and moving around and going to the bathroom, that whole thing. Hey, when God is sowing good word into good, nobody even moves. At one point I think, are they still even breathing? Because they're so hungry. There's times when you are so hungry for the word of God, you so want to hear what's being said, hey, that you're just grabbing it, man. It's like food, you know? But there are people who have hard hearts and they don't receive the word of God. And you know what comes? Nothing. Next soil type or next heart condition. He receives the seed on stony places. This is he who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Go. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures only for a while. Then when temptation and persecution arises because of the word, immediately he stumbles. You know this passage of scripture. But the second type of heart is something that when the word is preached, they receive it with joy. I can't tell you how many times people have run up here to the front and said, Pastor, what you said today, it was so good. It was like you were speaking just to me. And 4 weeks later, I don't even see them again. I can tell you probably 10 times or more, people have come to me at some point and said, Pastor, we've been coming to church here. We love the church here. This is going to be our home church. This is where we need. The Lord's telling us this is where we need to be. And within 2 months, I never see them again. It's this soil right here. They hear something. It really affects. You know what I mean? But, well, when hard things come, it's easy for the enemy to choke out, hey, something that has very little root. Some people hear and receive with joy, but because they don't get rooted, their soil isn't good. They just never, ever continue to, and they when they don't continue to grow, they die. I got that yawn right there. If I didn't love you, man, I wouldn't pick on you. You know that, right? Everybody's like. Next. Third type of soil, I'm hurrying. He who receives seed among the thorns hears the word, but the cares of the world, the deceitfulness of riches, choke the word and becomes unfruitful. I almost want to say, there's the American church for you. Hey, you hear the word and you start to grow and you know it's good, you know what you need, but you got so much of this other stuff going on in your life that you can't. We just finished the high school football season. 7-3. West Liberty did pretty good. 7-3, okay? It was everything for 10 weeks. Connor's up there today. He had a pretty good season. For him, a great season. It's a joke. I'm just kidding. I'm just picking on. He knows I'm picking on. Hey, but he's a pole vaulter. He's got colleges looking at him. The NFL, you don't have any NFL scouts picking you up, do you? No, the Browns, at least you've caught a touchdown, right? You got his stuff on right there. Just start yawning, you get me back. Again. Hey, and the things of this world become so important that all of a sudden we just don't have space for God anymore. For men, it can be work. The pressures of work and all this stuff's got to be done and customers angry or this thing or the boss is pushing and work and we push to work and we get so caught up in our work, we feel as men we're supposed to be providers and that's our job and that's what we do. And my dad died at 47. And when he was really sincerely honest and he knew he was running out of time, you know what he said? I didn't make enough time for the things that were really important, but he worked all the time. And women, there's a million things. I said men first because we're a lot easier. Women, oh my goodness, you got a million things to do. Don't you? I mean, you got at least 20 people to answer on Facebook. That's a joke. That's a total joke. I'm just kidding. Women, listen, I don't know how you guys do it. I do not know how you do it. Your life in the last 50 years, a woman's life has become so much more complicated than it's overwhelming. It is overwhelming the difficult things that women do. They work full time. They have all the choice that you have to do. You got all the stuff. You remember all the birthdays. You remember all the, just trust me, you're not going to be able to count on him to do that. And what happens is it chokes out the very important stuff of God. So we know we need God. We know that ought to be a priority. We know. But we're just so darn busy. It just all gets choked. It's just for the next 10 weeks. We'll just put God on hold for a while. We just can't. Just for a while. always feel like, you know, if God responded to me the way I responded to him, you know what I mean? Because if I pray to God and say, God, I need you right now. Well, it's football season. I'll see you in 10 weeks. Thanks, God. He made you a priority. When you pray to him, you have an expectation that he, that you're important, that he, I do. I believe that God hears me and God cares and God's working on my behalf. And I just got to be careful. I got to be careful that I don't let stuff choke out the word of God, the word of God that God wants to put in me, and he wants it to produce great, awesome and great things. You know, we talked a week or two ago about Apostle Paul saying, I wish you wouldn't even get married. Because as soon as you get married, there's a whole bunch of distractions. If you didn't get married, you could do all these things that I want you to do, the Lord wants you to do. So, the Apostle Paul teaches, just stay single. You'll be better able to serve the Lord staying single. I mean, that's how, but think about all the other things that come in that choke down. Tell me how many times you've had to decide whether I go to church or read my Bible. I just don't have time. So we get it, but we don't get it, and these things invade, and hey, and what it says is we become unfruitful. We know we need God. We know he's important. We know he's there somewhere, but we just aren't fruitful. We just aren't. The word of God, hey, the seed of God in you is supposed to produce something great. Here's the good, or I got to get to the end here. Here's the good soil, the good. But he who receives seed on good ground is he who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and produces some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Oh my goodness. Pastor, that's so wonderful. Man, if I hear your word and I go after God with all my heart, I can bring, at the very worst case, the very worst return on your investment is you get 30-fold back. You can't get that in the stock market. You can't get that anywhere, you know. You can't get that. The only place you can probably get that is you bet on a long shot at the track. That's a joke. Don't go do that. Hey, but the trick here is, God first, what God's speaking to me through his word needs to be very important to me. And what comes from that is some 100-fold increase. That's the word of God, man. It's the word of God. That you'll be so increased if you'll just get the God stuff. You know, the big promise is if you'll put God in his kingdom first, all these things you need will be added to you. God wants you to have an abundant life. Wants you to be blessed. But you got to get the good word of God working in your life. You hear me? And the thing that I guess I'm trying to get you committed to just by hearing this message is that God's word begins to be a regular part of your daily life. Pastor Mark, not another thing. No, this is a big thing. This is an important thing. My wife reads the Bible a lot. She tries to give people, when they're in trouble, the word of God as counsel. And people want sympathy more than they want the word of God. Does that make sense? When the word of God is what is going to be the thing that produces good fruit. I gotta let you go. The Bible. Where is that in your life? Daily bread in the bathroom. At least. Listen to the Word of God in your car, on your fancy phone. Just give it a shot. Give it a shot. Read to me Genesis chapter 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. It's that easy. It's that easy. Spend some of that time hearing God, and you watch how it affects you. Father, we thank you for time together today. Thank you for the good candy that was given to us, Lord, and for your blessing and richness in the Word. Thank you for these elders and deacons that serve in the church, and God, for just the heart of the people to give. May the Word light our path, Lord. May the preaching today help us to see the importance of it. That it's what really brings the increase in our life. Help us in these things that are a struggle for us, Lord. Time is just, it's so hard to work another thing in, God. But give us understanding about those things that are very important. Let the Word, Lord, penetrate our hearts today. Let it work its perfect work in us. We'll give you praise for that. We'll give you praise. We will. Let the Word change us forever, as I know it will. We'll forever give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thanks for coming, everybody. Good to see you today. Come back again, would you please? I hope you will.